it's non-universal and depends upon microscopic numbers. One of the things that one certainly has to think about if one is thinking about high-temperature superconductivity is TC. The whole field is named after this. So in a sense, everything that I'm going to discuss with you is focused on the question of how do we understand the large value of TC in the high-temperature superconductors, and how do we imagine raising it, how do we imagine finding other high-temperature superconductors. Unfortunately, this is a very difficult problem, and a problem that I won't have anything useful to say about directly, so I'm going to try to sneak up on it. And rather than engaging in generalities, what I'm first going to do is I'm going to walk you through the phase diagram of the cuprates. I'm not going to show you any experimental data or even refer specifically to any experiments. I'm going to make assertions about what's going on in different regions of the phase diagram. And the main purpose of this exercise is to identify a set of questions that I would like to address. I'm interested in the questions more generally. I think the high-temperature superconductors are in large part interesting as the best studied highly correlated electron system. And so I think thinking about high-temperature superconductors is a way of thinking about the broader and deeper problems of highly correlated electron systems without getting so lost in abstraction that you have something specific to focus on. But I'd like to just walk you through this to have in mind a set of questions. What I'm not going to do is directly answer any of those questions. So as I told you, I'm going to sneak up on all these problems. These questions are the motivation. Then what I'm going to spend the majority of my lectures discussing is certain simple model paradigmatic problems of interacting electrons in which I can actually look you in the face and say, I know what the behavior of these models is. And of course, every time I get a solution, I'm going to pontificate a little about what we learn. Not that I will get anything that I would expect to compare with experiment, but something that I hope will give us some qualitative feeling for what might be going on in real materials. So that's the strategy. In order to keep the discussion specific, I'm going to very quickly in each section focus on a particular model. Of course, the methods that I'm describing and the nature of solution are more generally applicable than that, but I'm not going to keep telling you that. I'm going to pretend, for instance, that the only thing that we would ever possibly care about is the Hubbard model on the square lattice with small u. I'm going to spend a lot of time on that problem, for instance, and not tell you over and over again why I think that this stupidly simple and unrealistic model problem is something we should spend so much time and care for. All right, so we're almost dry. So are there any questions about the strategy here? Okay, so.
Can you use the microphone?
What?
Can you use the microphone? I think that will help the recording.
Okay. I guess the answer is no. Yes.
I'm sorry, did you say small u?
Yeah. It's okay, if you're unhappy about that, I'll also solve the problem in the very, very large unit.
Small is how small?
So small.
Really teeny tiny.
Yeah. I actually do have a question.
Okay.
You said high-TC superconductivity is one of the best studied highly correlated systems.
Yes.
Are you sure it's best studied, not just most studied?
Yes. Yeah. There's no other material other than maybe silicon that we have such precise, detailed information about the electronic properties. We know at the phenomenological level a phenomenal amount about the Coupe rates. Now, you can ask whether all that precise and detailed understanding information is useful, or whether it's clouding our vision of what the big principles are because we know too many details. And I actually worry about this. Having been in this field so long, I know not only the crystal structure of each member of the cuprate family, but the name of the guy or woman who makes the best crystals of this particular material. So, you know, I'm counting on you to challenge my detailed understanding. But in terms of quality and depth and precision of information, there's just nothing in the same class.
How about in terms of microscopics?
Well, I don't know what you mean by that.
In
terms of microscopic information, experimental information about the structure of any electronic property you care, there's just no other material other than silicon that compares.
I mean microscopic mechanism as opposed to phenomenology.
Are you asking a theory question?
Yeah.
Okay. I was making a statement about experimental characterization.
Okay.
All right. So let me draw you my picture of the Coupe rate phase diagram. So there are two axes. There's temperature and there's doping concentration. And in case you care, I'll be more or less thinking about whole doped Coupe rates. There are many different whole doped Coupe rates, and they differ in some details concerning their phase diagrams. So this is not supposed to be a precise measurement of description of any one particular material. So already, I'm simplifying for you, but you'll see that what I draw is plenty complicated. And so, over here, there's an antiferromagnetic phase. On this line, it's certainly an antiferromagnetic insulating phase. Out here, it's a little bit more ambiguous what you want to call it in terms of its conduction properties. Certainly at zero temperature, it becomes an insulator. That's almost certainly due to disorder. Within this sliver, it exhibits metallic temperature dependence of the resistivity, that is to say, resistivity that's an increasing function of temperature. And so I'm going to leave out the usual I that goes here. What we know about this is that certainly it's an antiferromagnet, and I'm not going to comment on things that I don't know. And then there's the high temperature superconducting phase. And we know quite a bit about this. In particular, we know that this is a D-wave superconductor, and that's very robust. Now, there are a number of other things that are fairly general on this phase diagram. There's a mysterious line that comes down in some way like this, which is called T star. And below this line is a mysterious region of the phase diagram called the pseudo-gap. And it's called the pseudo-gap in large part because we don't have a more affirmative title for it. We know some things about it. For instance, that there is a suppression of low energy density of states. It's measured in various different ways. But exactly how you're supposed to think about that is unclear. And within this phase, there's a variety of other ordering tendencies, which are sometimes called competing. But I want to try to explain to you why I would like you to call them intertwined orders. And I'll talk about that a little bit.
Excuse me, the Keystone line goes to the x equals 0, or it just stops somewhere?
So, you know, since this line is a little bit ill-defined, it's a little bit ill-defined how you want to end it. So there are certainly lines that have been identified in experiment that penetrate into the superconducting dome, and I will talk about those. And there are certainly pseudo-gap phenomena that extend beyond, and to some extent, which way we draw it seems to depend a little bit on which particular material in the family we look at, so I'm going to leave it like this. But that's a good question. And up here is a regime which is even less understood. I call it a bad metal. It's sometimes called a strange metal. It's sometimes called marginal thermal liquid. Each of these names stresses different aspects of the phenomenology here. I'm going to have very little to say about this. I think understanding this phase, which is a regime in which the behavior of the system is extremely simple. It's very easy to describe, but all we really know about it is that it doesn't behave like any familiar state of matter that we understand. And this bad metal behavior seems to be fairly ubiquitous at room temperature and above in a vast variety of highly correlated electron systems. So understanding what this is in a sense a problem on the scale of the great problems in solid state physics of understanding what a metal is and what a semiconductor is and what an insulator is. I think understanding what a bad metal is of similar scope and importance. Yes?
Do you have examples of non-high TC superconductors that also have strange or bad metals? And how are the properties different?
So, of course, partly it depends on how you characterize them. But the reason I stress bad metal is the most easy thing to measure is the resistivity. And the characteristic of this regime that's most difficult to reconcile with any conventional understanding is that you have a metallic temperature dependence of the resistance. That is to say, the resistance is an increasing function of temperature. In fact, it's typically T-linear. But with a magnitude that, if interpreted in terms of Boltzmann transport, would imply a mean free path that was shorter than the de Broglie wavelength. Okay, so that taking that as the definition, so the coupe rates all show it, the iron-based superconductors all show it, strontium-ruthenate shows it, strontium-ruthenate 214, which at low temperatures is a Fermi liquid and then an unconventional superconductor, strontium-ruthenate 327, which is some weird almost ferromagnet and almost pneumatic at low temperature, but at high temperature it's a bad metal, and strontium-ruthenate 113, which has a transition, which is nearly cubic, and has a transition to a ferromagnetic metallic state at 150 Kelvin. But it goes on. TTF-TCNQ, which is a quasi-one-dimensional system with a charge density wave ground state. I won't go on, but it's a list that includes quasi-one-dimensional, quasi-two-dimensional, and nearly cubic materials. It's a list that includes things that are superconductors, Fermi liquids, charge density waves, spin density waves, ferromagnets at low temperature. It sort of is got an integrity all its own, and all of these complex phase diagrams that we're used to of highly correlated electron systems seem to grow out of this. But it's not clear that there's any specific clue in this phase about high temperature superconductivity in particular. Yeah.
And there's a recent article by Bruin and McKenzie in Science in 2013 that addresses exactly this point.
That's a very interesting paper. There's also somewhat older, but more, I mean, the McKenzie paper is, I think, a brilliant paper, but it's very provocative paper. It takes a very radical position on what this means. There's a really, really lovely review by Nigel Hussey and Takagi and somebody else. And I'll get you a reference if you're interested.
Steve?
Yeah.
So, just like in some of the high TC superconductors that TC suppressed all the way down to 10 Kelvin, the linearity seems to persist down to those very low temperatures. In any of the other examples you have mentioned, is there evidence for this linear T behavior persisting to extremely low temperatures?
So, the best single example of T-linear behavior down to low temperature and high temperature is in strontium-ruthenate 327 at 7.9 Tesla. This is addressing your question. I really know way, way too much detail about this show. Let me just describe that to you. Because this part's off the record. Okay. So at 1.5 Kelvin, there's a transition there to a nematic phase. And then there's the most perfectly linear T-linear resistivity between 1.5 Kelvin and approximately 30 Kelvin. And then there's somewhat of a shift, and there's a T-linear behavior that goes on up to about 1400 Kelvin. Now, yeah?
Now just, can you write down that pair of material, otherwise people may be confused about two phase data.
So this seems to be a different example. This is a symbolic time that, you know, there is a high temperature regime of linear resistivity, and then below 30 Kelvin, there's a different regime of a different kind of linear resistivity.
Well, so
that's
a question. So, I mean, I've exaggerated, of course, how sharp this is. Andy McKenzie looks at this and extracts from this a scattering rate, h bar over tau equals k Boltzmann t, and says that what's happening is that there's a temperature-dependent mass renormalization so that the current carrying excitations, whatever they are, undress somewhat, but that there's a single T-linear relaxation rate throughout this whole regime. I see in it just what you said, that there's a low temperature T-linear regime and a high temperature T-linear regime, and they're different. But what it does do is it makes you want to go back and look very, very carefully at situations where people say there's T-linear resistivity both at high and low temperatures. If you didn't look at this really closely, and if this data wasn't extraordinarily precise, you would miss this. So I was addressing Mohit's question. Just to explain the point, there's two sorts of attitudes that have been taken about trying to understand the T-linear resistivity. One is that it's somehow a feature of a quantum critical point. Now, exactly how you get T-linear resistivity out of a quantum critical point is itself a vexed issue. But let's put it aside. There certainly are examples in nature. That is a possibility, but then it's hard to understand, first place, why so many materials happen to be close to a quantum critical point, and why this quantum critical behavior could persist up to such high temperatures. Conversely, there's an attitude that maybe this is what happens at temperatures higher than some coherent scale in the problem. It's certainly at temperatures low compared to characteristic electronic energies like the bandwidth, but maybe there's some incoherent crossover and that this is high temperature behavior. But then if you look at materials like the single layer disco, you want to ask yourself, why does that high temperature behavior persist down to such low temperatures? And so these are the sort of questions that one needs to address if one wants to understand this. Partly, then, we don't know exactly which phenomena to include in this until we have the right theoretical framework for discussing it. Are there any other questions?
The ranges in parameter space over which this kind of linear behavior seems in the other examples also kind of looking like fans, which one might be tempted to interpret in one way or another?
So in Strontium-Ruthenate 327, this T-linear behavior is magnetic field independent. So at low temperatures, you're tuning yourself to some quantum critical point with field. At high temperatures, you see this. That doesn't necessarily answer your question.
Yeah.
But, you know, if it's a fan, it's a damn broad fan. Yeah.
Is the antiferromagnetic order long range?
And yes.
I guess my understanding is that long range antiferromagnetic order implies that it's an insulator. But is that only true like in model systems or
no. So look, in the absence of disorder, if you have other than one electron per unit cell, or two with the doubled unit cell, then by conventional reasoning, you would expect it to be a metal, right? So in fact, the Slater expectation would be that this might or might not be a metal, an insulator. That depends on details of nesting. But that this out here would certainly be a metal. So, in fact, the expectation from simple reasoning goes the other way. Now, of course, there could be other orders here, like charge density wave order on top of antiferromagnetism, which could give rise to intrinsic insulating behavior. But without some other order, it's either a conductor or it's really exotic. Any other questions? Okay, good. So there are a couple of other things I'd like to sketch on this phase diagram, just in case you think that it's too simple. There's another phase that really truly exists, in the sense that it's a broken symmetry, which is spin glass order. Spin glass order is characterized by the breaking of time reversal symmetry, and so it has a sharp distinction. The phase boundary may be a little bit complicated to infer, as the exact ordering temperature depends somewhat on the time scales on which you do your measurements, but there certainly is a spin glass phase here at low doping. And then the other thing I wanted to draw on this is that if you apply a high magnetic field to this problem, the superconducting phase breaks into two domes, which seem to be centered about particular dopants. So these are for some h that's less than the maximum HC2, but is still fairly substantial. And since the topic of quantum critical points came up, then let me point out that there seem to be a variety of at least apparent quantum critical points. There's one here where antiferromagnetism ends. There's one here, maybe I'll call it X minus, at the transition between a superconductor and an insulator at low doping. There's one here, which seems to be the last point at which superconductivity survives in a high magnetic field. There's one here, which is actually where the optimal HC2 occurs.
Sorry, that's the one that lasts the longest. In
that's the one that's, this is a local.
A local maximum.
Right.
And not in LSCO. It's not clear there's two bumps in LSCO.
Yeah, that's true. There's also more magnetism through here in LSCO. But so we should discuss LSCO. That's a very good point. And there's a superconductor to metal transition that occurs here. And all of these are presumably quantum critical points with potentially interesting quantum critical phenomena.
Just yep. To follow up on Greg's question, this dashed lines TC of H that you've drawn, to the best of my understanding, that's only seen in YBCO.
Well, so it's certainly seen in LBCO, both in zero field and in zero field, it turns out that these two things, you know, the TC doesn't go quite to zero here, but it goes almost to zero. But in relatively small fields, it does exactly this. But there's similar data, older data, not as good, from BISCO 2212.
It gets complex because in LBCO, it drops to zero at 1/8, whereas your X1 is also at 1/8.
No, X1 isn't at 1/8. X1 in YBCO is at about 8%. Yeah, this minimum here always seems to occur at 1/8,
yeah.
Where it's been seen. Yes?
Is there also a normal metal phase on the right side?
There's a metallic phase.
So no.
This is certainly a metal. It certainly behaves more like a normal metal than anything else in the cuprate phase diagram. maybe we should leave it at that. Okay? Yeah?
At the quantum critical point X1, does the spin glass vanish exactly there?
Maybe. it's certainly close. I don't know what it's, you know, spin glass phase boundaries are notoriously difficult to establish anyway. So, look, I'm sorry that I so oversimplified the phase diagram, but it's in the same neighborhood.
So experimentally, how do you determine that spin glass phase using what kind
of NMR? So NMR sees zero field precession, or μSR. They're very, very slow, so you know, effectively they see static magnetic fields. So if you see static magnetic fields, then you know the time reversal symmetry has been broken. It's a local probe, so it's almost impossible to break time reversal symmetry without it showing up in NMR and μSR. Right. Good question. Let me just repeat the question in case people didn't hear it. Does X2 have to do with the termination of T star? Okay, so quantum phase transitions, at least continuous quantum phase transitions, have to separate two distinct phases. That's not quite true, of course. The critical point at the liquid gas, the edge of the liquid gas first order line is a continuous phase transition that separates two phases of matter that aren't distinct. So one phase of matter. But except under fine-tuned circumstances, critical points, quantum critical points, in particular, separate two distinct phases of matter. Now, the two distinct phases of matter can be distinguished in various ways. They can be have different broken symmetries. If they have different broken symmetries, then we need to identify them by their different broken symmetries. There's all sorts of stuff that occurs in here. Most of it certainly does not involve broken symmetries. For instance, there's been a lot of excitement that you will probably hear about the observation of charge density wave order here. But the charge density wave order has finite range and therefore is not a broken symmetry. It's a system trying to break a symmetry somehow, but it's not a distinct phase of matter. In describing the properties of the system here, it might be reasonable to think about it in terms of a broken symmetry. But in terms of critical phenomena, it's a difference whether you've got a phase transition or not. Now, again, even that, anything you say has caveats. You know, if the correlation length is long enough, you're going to get a crossover. You're not going to get a phase transition, but you'll get a crossover. If the correlation length is very long, the crossover will be very sharp. And unless you get really, really close in to the critical point, you won't be able to tell the difference between it and a critical point. So we can negotiate about how principled we want to be about this critical point. But if we want to be principled about it, then the fact that there's no charge density wave long-range order, there's no magnetic long-range order, that means that I can't associate this with any of those orders. Now, there are, in various of these coup rates, sharp phase transitions that involve changing of the crystalline symmetry, tetragonal to orthorhombic, orthorhombic to tetragonal. Those are real genuine phase transitions. We generally tend to think about them as being sort of uninteresting. The electron fluid lives in the crystal. We want to think about the crystal as little as possible, so we think about its symmetry as little as possible. And certainly if the changes in symmetry are driven by, you know, mismatch of bismuth oxide bond lengths with copper oxide bond lengths, and if the transitions occur without too much change in the electronic structure, then we're right to ignore it. On the other hand, sometimes the symmetry changes, as in the iron-based superconductors, are responding to an interesting electronic symmetry breaking, what we'll call pneumatic, electron-pneumatic symmetry breaking. And so it's possible that there are phase boundaries that come in here and end at this point that are ultimately associated with breaking of point group symmetries. I'm optimistic about that, but it certainly hasn't been universally established. There is old Kerr data which showed the onset of a Kerr effect. We have achieved an extremely refined level of not understanding anything at all about what the Kerr effect is measuring, but it's certainly measuring something that looks like a phase transition in the sense that the Kerr effect is zero above some temperature and non-zero below it. And if you draw the lines of the onset of Kerr effect, it maybe goes like this. And that certainly suggests that some phase boundary separating finite temperature phases with higher symmetry and lower symmetry maybe terminates here, and that this quantum critical point could be associated with that. But this is things that are still being sorted out. Yes?
Confused. So on application of magnetic field, does the bigger dome still exist, or?
So no. So in the high magnetic field, the phase, the superconducting phase boundaries become these dashed.
And what characterizes the region between those two domes?
So, what characterizes this is metallic behavior with small electron pockets. So in this phase diagram, there's actually an extremely good Fermi liquid with some funny reconstructed Fermi surface that lies here.
It also bad metal behavior.
No, okay, I don't. No, no, it's got to be good because it's, you see very, very, I mean, you see quantum oscillations. So you know you have quasi particles with very long mean free paths. So here in this dashed thing, we have some reconstructed in the sense that the Fermi surface is very different from the band structure Fermi surface. It consists of very small pockets, but nonetheless ultimately a Fermi liquid. And whether there are other broken symmetries associated with this or not is not clear at present. Yes?
Since you put a line of Kerr effect, where do you put another color line with another color where rotational symmetry is broken?
Rotational symmetry.
You might.
Yeah, so I think... that this is a pneumatic phase boundary also.
Sorry, I thought the transport anisotropy onset of T star.
It doesn't. It used to. So, I have a list. You guys are probably too young to know what I'm referring to.
You're also too young.
What?
You're also too young. It's from the 19th century.
No. I'm referring to McCarthyism. Anyway, so at any rate, there's really wonderful new data from Louis Taillefer's group on transport anisotropy in YVCO, which was reported at the March meeting, if any of you happen to have been at the appropriate 10-minute talk. It's, I can't resist. It's such a, I'm a theorist, I don't know about experiment, but this sounds really classy to me. They put on all the leads on the crystal so that they can measure the resistivity, the hole resistivity, the Peltier coefficient, the transverse Peltier coefficient, the thermal conductivity, all of the thermal and electrical transport properties of the system. And they detwin the crystal so that the A axis is this way and the B axis is that way. And they do all these measurements, And then they take the crystal and re-detwin it so that the A-axis is this way and the B-axis is that way. So they can measure the transport anisotropy without ever changing the geometry of the current paths or the nature of the contacts or so on. They just change which is the A direction and which is the B direction. And in this way, they're able to see which transport coefficients best indicate the onset of pneumatic anisotropy. Okay, they claim it's a pneumatic phase transition, which of course we know can't be because YVCO happens to already have broken the requisite symmetries. But at any rate, they see a very sharp onset of pneumaticity, best measured in the anisotropy of the Pelletier coefficient at a line that just lies right on the Kerr onset, and with a, and by the way, also the onset of short-range charge density wave correlation. So, you know, I think that there's good reason to be optimistic that there's an actual phase transition line somewhere here which terminates there, but it's not known.
I'm sorry.
You're forgiven.
What is pneumaticity?
What is pneumaticity? Good. This was, by the way, supposed to be the first 20 minutes of the talk. So pneumaticity in classical liquid crystals, complex fluids, is a state that spontaneously breaks rotation symmetry, but nothing else. So the cartoon picture of a pneumatic is the following. Suppose we have a fluid that's made out of cigar-shaped molecules. And so at high temperatures, they're all over the place and they're pointing in all directions. And then at some low temperature or higher density, as we squeeze them together, they can't fit like this. So they sort of line up. They're still flowing all over the place. This is supposed to be pictures of a snapshot of the fluid. And so the molecules can be anywhere. There's no breaking of translation symmetry, but there is breaking of rotational symmetry, so this direction is different from that direction. Now, it's not a ferroelectric. I've preserved these are up-down symmetric situations, so it still preserves reflection symmetry, inversion symmetry. That's a pneumatic. In the electronic context, it means an electronic state that spontaneously breaks the point group symmetry of the underlying crystal while preserving inversion symmetry. Okay? Is that's a definition that we'll do for now.
So, I'm sorry, but just to clarify, because I think it's kind of important. So, this is the same of so-called orbital ordering, right?
So in terms of symmetry, there's no difference. So all of these things in terms of broken symmetry are characterized. So suppose you had a cubic system. So then any symmetric tensor quantity, say the dielectric tensor, would be diagonal. In a pneumatic phase, this will develop a traceless symmetric piece. This is the pneumatic order. In terms of broken symmetry, that's all there is. In terms of microscopic mechanisms, you can ask, does this come from a lattice distortion? Does this come from orbital ordering? Does this come from some other more subtle electronic correlations? Those are microscopic questions. We're right now asking phase transition questions. Microscopic questions are important. Phase transition questions are different. Okay?
Yes. Yeah, that's a good question. I assume that the Kerr effect cannot detect the spin glass phase, correct? correct? Because it's not local.
That's a very good question, and I think the answer is we don't know. So the Kerr effect nominally detects time reversal symmetry breaking. Spin glass breaks time reversal symmetry. So it's quite plausible that a Kerr effect could detect the spin glass. On the other hand, we're pretty sure that time reversal symmetry isn't broken up here, and the Kerr effect still is detecting something, and we really don't understand that. We've got a list of possibilities, which is another way of saying that we don't understand it. Yes?
Going back to the strange metal space, we talked about transport measurements, like the linear behavior. How universal or non-universal is the thermodynamics of the cuprates or other systems you mentioned in those things? Or what can that tell us?
Yeah, so that's an extremely natural question to ask. It's really stupid that we're talking about transport before talking about thermodynamics. Problem is, it's not easy to measure anything interesting thermodynamic in that region. So for instance, the specific heat is so totally dominated by lattice vibrations that you can't measure it without doing enormous subtractions. And if you do enormous subtractions, you probably can get any answer you want. Magnetic susceptibility, for instance, it has a very weakly temperature-dependent magnetic susceptibility. It looks like it could be a Pauli susceptibility. But, I don't know. That doesn't tell us much. It's one of these peculiar things. Whenever we talk about the future of solid-state physics, we talk about all of these brilliant new probes that we have, and they are brilliant, and they're really driving the field forward. But it's still true that 95% of all discoveries in solid-state physics are made by measuring the resistance. And the resistance, from my point of view as a theorist, is just about the most horrible thing you could imagine. But it's something that we just have to deal with because it's what you measure.
Are there dense waves in the
supraconducting
region?
Are there what?
Dense waves.
So there certainly is short range, that is to say, with a finite correlation like charge density wave order coexisting with superconductivity in this regime. Some of these materials, there's also incommensurate spin density wave order, which coexists with superconductivity in quite a remarkable way, actually. So there's no inconsistency with density wave order and superconductivity. It tends to be in regimes where the superconducting TC is somewhat suppressed. Yes?
Why is the spin glass phase at broken time reversal? I mean,
have what?
Broken time reversal. I would have thought that glass implies a disordered kind of.
It's disordered, but it breaks time reversal symmetry. So, spin glass phase is. This is the order parameter of a spin glass phase. So. The brackets represent the thermal or quantum average, and then the bar represents the configuration average over the disorder.
So what is this order then? The charge or?
Spin. So what this means is that in any given realization of the disorder, the spin will freeze in some complicated way. So that's a picture of the ground state of a spin glass, or a ground state, of course. It's still, we haven't put on any spin orbit coupling. Those can point, we can have, take that ground state and globally rotate it by an SU2 transformation. But, so every point in space has some magnetic field. It's just that they're randomly oriented. So if I averaged over space, or averaged over configurations, this would be zero. Now, I also drew a spin glass phase here coexisting with antiferromagnetism. The definition of that phase is a little bit more complicated. It's usually described in terms of replica symmetry breaking, and that's a subtlety that I'm happy to discuss with you, but not here. You have a question?
Well, in some sense, a question from the organizer. You gave an extremely simple phase diagram with very few details. And maybe you can say a few words about what are not details. What is the challenge here?
Right, so that's what I wanted to get to, but I wanted to answer the questions on this. So let me tell you what the questions are that this phase diagram raises, unless they're more pressing questions before I go on. Good.
That's why Steve started his lecture.
What?
Now you start your lecture.
No, I'm not quite ready to ask to start my lecture yet. Okay, so here are the questions that we would like to address. One, why is PC so large? Okay, this is a totally unrespectable question for a theorist to be asking, but I think it's unavoidable. Two, why and how is superconductivity associated with antiferromagnetism?
Steve, can you say large compared to what in question one?
Large compared to anything else that's ever been looked at. It's an order of magnitude bigger than any other superconductor that was known at the time.
In that sense, an absolute number in Kelvin. That's
absolute number in Kelvin. As I said, this is not a theoretically respectable question.
When I used to dabble in high TCs in my postdoctoral year, people turned this question around and said, why is it so low?
yeah.
Very large K, right? Very large U and very large.
Yeah. So, that's, of course, a good theorist's question. The question you might ask, let me just rephrase, let me explain the question. In these materials, in fact, they've been discussed as being strong coupling materials, but that's a fallacy. They're intermediate coupling materials. All numbers are comparable to each other. And therefore, there's no small parameters in the problem. And therefore, wouldn't you expect TC or any other property of the system to be equal to a number of order 1 times the microscopic energies in the problem? And in that case, TC is very low. So why is TC so low? Okay, so that's what the question is. But as a practical question, it's clearly, why is TC so high? Somehow or other, nature conspires to make superconducting transitions low, and it conspires a little bit less in the cuprates. Let me also point out that big numbers of order 1 do occur in solid-state physics. For instance, if we look at the one-component plasma in two dimensions and ask what is the temperature at which it transitions to a Wigner crystal, the answer obviously is some energy of order the interparticle interaction, V. And that answer is right, but that number turns out to be some, from numerics, turns out to be something like 1 over 125. Okay, live with it. Should I go on?
Why not?
What?
Why not?
Why is it B wave? And This one, at least, I think we really understand. What is a pseudo-gap? What, if any, is its relation to superconducting fluctuations? Okay, so it's known that the form of the pseudo gap in K space on the Fermi surface has some similarities to the form of the superconducting gap. And that certainly leads to the idea that maybe somehow this pseudo gap is the intrinsic superconducting TC, and that somehow this is a failed, really high temperature superconductor that fluctuations of one sort or another have suppressed. That, of course, if true, is extremely important, because then we can just go to work trying to figure out how to stabilize that higher temperature superconductor. But, okay. And what other orders are intertwined? So here, let me just say, the orders here certainly compete in some way with superconductivity. This has been established experimentally. As one order grows, superconductivity is suppressed. As superconductivity is suppressed, some of these other orders grow. We have many, is that me? Okay. What? Tornado alarm. Okay, good. But when I was in high school, we heard an unknown alarm. We convinced my teacher that it was a flood alarm. We were all supposed to stand on our desks. it's not surprising that orders compete with each other. But the notion of competing orders has the implication that it's an unimportant part of the problem, that this is some nasty feature of these particular materials, and if we can just figure out how to get rid of them, well then maybe TC is gonna come flying up here. But it's not, it's basically an unfortunate accident rather than an intrinsic piece of the problem. But I think it's now increasingly clear from the fact that these other orders appear ubiquitously in the cuprates, and in fact, similar patterns of competing orders seem to appear in the iron nictides as well, the iron-based superconductors as well. And so it seems to me that the relation between these other orders and superconductivity is much more profound. That is to say, they may ultimately compete, but somehow or other they're linked. The things you have to do to the Hamiltonian to make the system a candidate for high temperature superconductivity inevitably also bring in these other orders. And that's the sense in which intertwined is the notion I would like you to carry away. I'm not going to discuss, this is an issue that I'm extremely interested in. I'm not going to talk about it, but I hope before the end of the week to post a colloquium review that I'm writing with Eduardo Fratkin and John Tranquada on this, rather than talking about it. At any rate, many of these things have been mentioned, but there are many, many orders for which, in various levels of confidence, evidence that can be interpreted with various levels of confidence have been adduced in this region, there's certainly charge density wave order, there's some forms of spin density wave order sometimes, there's pneumatic order, which we've already discussed, although the issue of there's certainly many different structural phase transitions that occur in this general range of temperature and doping, and how the structural and electronic symmetry breakings are related is something that still needs to be worked out. There's spin glass order. There may be pair density wave order, which is a finite momentum pairing superconducting order. There's some evidence, exciting but certainly unconclusive, of the existence of such a phase. There may be various forms of orbital current order, either within a unit cell or at some finite ordering vector. And then there's always the possibility of more exotic orders, some form of topological order, which could play a role somewhere in this phase diagram. I was going to digress on that, but I won't. Okay. What is the nature of the various quantum critical points? So my goodness, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of them at least. Quantum critical points are interesting. Yeah?
Sorry, is it clear that all of them are quantum critical points as opposed to quantum phase transitions of another type?
Well, there is certainly no evidence of a first order phase transition in any of these. So if it's not a first order phase transition, then it's a quantum critical point, presumably. Now, whether people have looked sufficiently carefully to rule out weakly first order phase transition in any of these cases, I think probably not. You know, so as I said, quantum critical points are interesting in their own right, and so they're certainly worth discussing. Whether they're important in the broader scheme of things somehow depends upon non-universal things like what is their reach. If they have quantum critical regions that live inside my chalk dot, then, okay, it's definitely worth studying them because we're interested in quantum critical points, but it's certainly in a different subject than high temperature superconductivity. And we have to ask, are these the best examples to study? If, on the other hand, their reach is substantial, then we want to understand them. There's been actually surprisingly little attention paid to these two quantum critical points. Since they're quantum critical points that involve the superconductivity directly, that seems a little bit funny. And I have quite a lot to say about this, but I won't. Yes. Yeah.
There's one sort of general remark in the phase diagram and talking about quantum critical points, the first order transition and so on. Because everyone on the planet draws the phase diagram like this, T versus X. But in thermodynamics, we are taught to draw the phase diagram as a function of chemical potential and temperature rather than temperature and X. Because that's the foot key that has the same value for the system. And so the transitions which, to some of these issues of first order versus quantum critical in homogeneity, maybe, what all really first order transition is to draw the phase diagram the right way as a function of chemical potential. But then, because they're forced to draw it as a function of X, space.
Okay, so I have a number of things to say about that. So, first place, my entire approach to the problem is based on the notion that the transition out of the antiferromagnet is intrinsically first order, and that everything has to do with mesoscale phase separation. So I'm emotionally in accord with what you're saying. However, I also have to differ with you, which is that really, truly, we're dealing with charged particles here. And for charged particles, the chemical potential is not what we should be doing. The concentration is, the phase diagram has to be drawn as a function of the density of the uniform background charge. So, you know, in our minds, we would like to see some ideal phase diagram of some Hubbard or TJ model, and there, you're completely right, the phase diagram should be drawn as a function of chemical potential, and as long as there are no first-order phase transitions, we can transform back and forth, but the moment first-order phase transitions occur, we need, that's not a convenience, it's a necessity, but for the materials, because of Coulomb interactions, I think it's still right to draw it as a function of x. I should also say that in at least some of the materials, there's considerable evidence that across a broad range of doping here, the chemical potential is almost independent of doping, which is to say the system is certainly trying as hard as it can to phase separate. So that's certainly an important piece of the physics here. Good. I want you to know I prepared 27 pages of notes for today, and I'm on page 3. What are universal aspects? So, again, we're interested in physics. Things that occur in particular materials, if they're interesting, are interesting. And so, for instance, there's a lot of evidence that this pair density wave state that I mentioned exists right near 1/8 doping in one particular cuprate, lanthanum barium copper oxide. Right, that's enough for me to be interested in it. But for me to talk about it in a mixed audience like this, I would have to have some evidence that it's more universal, that it's a feature of the cuprate phase diagram, not just a feature of a particular cuprate. And this question has many aspects, that is to say, which features of these that I've been talking about are really general across whole doped cuprates. We can take that as a family that we're interested in. Those are, after all, the highest temperature superconductors and have many features in common with each other. We can think about that as being the family. We can include the electron doped materials. And here there's a big piece of new news, again, that is not in the form of a document that I can publicly distribute, but I was allowed to show figures at the Gordon Conference last week. Before, whenever it was, which is that in this regime of the phase diagram, short-range charge density wave order, very similar to what's seen in the hole-doped cuprates, has now been reported in the electron-doped cuprates by two different groups. We might want to include here the iron-based superconductors and focus on things that are general not just to the cuprates, but to our two best characterized families of high temperature superconductors. We might compare with other unconventional superconductors I know that since Manfred spoke last week, you know what an unconventional superconductor is. And we might even want to ask about what features might be general to superconductors with high TCs. That is to say, we might want to look at the conventional superconductors with the highest transition temperatures, like, for instance, the A15s. All right. How can we change TC? Okay. This is, again, a question that is normally considered pretty disreputable for a theorist to think about. This is material science. But in fact, I think this is something that we should think about very seriously. Probably thinking about how we're going to find new high-temperature superconductors, what material, new materials or something, that may be awfully hard. That may be unrealistic. But, you know, for sure, if we really understand the mechanism of superconductivity, we should know how to make small changes in TC. That should be something we should be able to predict. And, in fact, turning it around, that's not only intrinsically interesting. Obviously, learning how to raise TC, for instance, is something that a lot of people would, you know, be willing to celebrate if you could figure out how to do it. But just from a purely theoretical point of view, it may be in some senses a good unbiased test of whether you've actually understood something. So, for instance, in conventional superconductors, we understand, on the basis of Anderson's theorem, why TC is remarkably insensitive to disorder. You might have thought that when the mean free path got to be shorter than the coherence length, that you've messed up the important correlations that gave rise to superconductivity. But since the coherence lengths in conventional superconductors are 1,000 angstroms, that would mean you would have to have only extraordinarily pure materials to be superconductors. In fact, we understand, because we have a microscopic theory that we believe, we understand that there's no reduction in TC at all until we start running into localization physics. The mean free path can be as short as you like, and it just doesn't matter. Okay, and that understanding of the insensitivity to disorder is actually one of the key successes of the conventional theory of superconductivity. Understanding how making the ion mass larger or smaller increases TC or decreases TC. Again, it's a small effect, but it gives us great confidence that we've really understood something profound about the mechanism of conventional superconductivity. And so I think this is something we should think about very seriously. Of course, there's the much more ambitious question. this is a question that's so important that it's worth money. There's a major initiative of the American government called, Greg, you introduced me to it. Materials Genome Project. And the idea of this project is that theory is cheaper than experiment, and since theory is going to be so good, we're going to do theoretical experiments to find new interesting materials, including higher temperature superconductors, and we're going to put money into that rather than into actually exploring materials. Okay, so you have to have an opinion on this. I have an opinion on it. I think this is an evil idea. But at any rate, that reflects my pessimism, not that this isn't a good question.
And to clarify, it's focusing money on exascale computing to do that, as opposed to kind of what you're doing.
You keep talking.
Which I think has great merit.
What?
Which I think has great merit.
I know. And finally, what is a bad metal? And I've already explained why I think that's such an important problem. All right, so.
There was an earlier remark about whether bad metal behavior existed down at lower temperatures, and it does seem to persist. I'll show some data right near that X2 on critical point. If you define it as linear T.
Right. So, that, of course, that was a very precise statement, and I like that. One of the things we do want to understand is what are the things we need to characterize this phase. Good. So these are the questions I want you to have in mind in the next three lectures as I try to actually do some theory. Let me give you some preview. I think this problem, we understand. We understand it in many different ways. I will explain it to you by solving the Hubbard model in the limit in which U is parametrically small. I'll explain to you why I think that's a reasonable thing to do, although it's not a theory of high temperature superconductivity, it's a theory of astronomically low temperature superconductivity, but it's a theory that's easily extrapolated to intermediate couplings. It connects with various well-known approximate solutions of the same problem that have a very similar structural form as the weak coupling solution. They're distinct, but they're formally very similar to each other, and they connect very smoothly, which answer the question about why and how superconductivity is associated with short range antiferromagnetic order. I will study the properties of the various quasi one-dimensional Hubbard models, again, which I can solve, and will at least show you examples of problems that we can solve and understand which have a pseudo gap, which in fact have a non-Fermi liquid normal state, which might be some caricature of the bad metal, and in which we can see why, even in a problem in which we understand everything, that it's very hard to put words to the question, what is the pseudo gap? And I think maybe I'll have a little time to talk about this. And that's it. All right, so are there any questions?
Will you talk about the topological transitions?
Topological transitions, I will not. But I can talk about them if you like in the remaining 5 minutes. Yes?
Since you aren't going to say more about what is a bad metal, I assume.
Yeah.
Maybe you could say a few words about, other than linear resistivity, what are the common features of all the bad metallic data that you're aware of?
Right. Good. I can do that very quickly because there isn't much. Okay, so first, let me draw rho, the resistivity, in units of the quantum of resistance. And for me, the quantum of resistance, I'm very eccentric because I'm 60, is defined in terms of fundamental constants of nature. Minus V minus 2, if you must know.
So it should be the other one.
What?
Resistance, so it's H over it. Conduct?
Yes, thank you. Which in three dimensions is equal to 135 micro-ohm centimeters. Which happens to be the resistivity within 20% of any liquid metal or any amorphous metal. It happens to be the resistivity at which conventional metals exhibit resistivity saturation. I think it's sort of nice that you can estimate that without knowing anything about materials. So here's one. And so the first thing that bad metals tend to do is they have a T-linear resistivity, but not only that, they have a T-linear resistivity that surpasses this value. So up here, this can't be understood in terms of Boltzmann transport. Down here, it maybe can. And so there's a question, which is the question that's been brought up several times, about how long do you continue to think that this is a bad metal? Now, an argument that we made a long time ago is that if the resistivity shows no crossover behavior, then probably there's no crossover behavior in the physics. And that if we agree that this up here can't be understood in terms of Boltzmann theory, then probably this can't be. But that's, the validity of that has to be tested.
Excuse me? When you say Boltzmann theory? What?
Boltzmann transport. Some notion of coherent quasi-particles propagating and scattering. So the way we understand metallic transport is that we think, Bloch's theorem. At zero temperature, my quasi-particles have infinite mean free path, the resistivity is zero. And then as I screw the system up, either by putting in disorder or by increasing thermal fluctuations of whatever sort, the mean free path gets shorter, and therefore the resistivity is an increasing function of temperature. Okay? But if we don't have anything coherent quasi-particle light that's propagating, then we don't even know why the resistivity has any temperature dependence at all. Yes?
Can I ask, we always talk about the linear, but there's no real reason it has to be linear.
I agree.
Any power law, anything really should be...
Correct. The thing that I think is important is that it goes smoothly past this point. It just so happens that very many of these materials have T-linear resistance. Since I don't have a theory of it, I'm certainly not wedded to it.
So the only thing we really know is the quadratic from liquid like at very low temperatures.
Well, no. I mean, in conventional metals, you see a resistivity that, you know, does block Grünheisen, and then if the coupling's big enough, it saturates.
Are you willing to stake your life on this being saturated and not just the decreasing slope?
No, but there's a crossover that occurs. You know, this is coherent quasi-particle transport. Coherent quasi-particle transport breaks down here, and the theory crosses over to some other behavior. It's in fact a considerable embarrassment that I don't think we have a good theory, even of resistivity saturation in conventional metals. Yeah?
Then the question was about bad metal. Come on. There are a number of systems. Let's put them as...
I'm supposed to end, by the way, now.
In 30 seconds.
Okay.
There are a number of systems which, let's put them, let's say something, in the quantum physical region, which show complete incoherence in single particle properties. Yet, if you include all the nasty of Unklapp's or hot versus cold regions, Levine-Rice conundrum, etc., they all show conventional T-square resistivity, at least in theory language.
Right.
So the question is in this regard, is bad means linear resistivity, or bad means no well-defined quasi-particle heat?
Right. So bad is a negative statement. It says that this can't be explained by coherent quasi-particle transport. It doesn't say what it can be explained by. Now, the second thing that I'm going to mention, I think, addresses this to some extent, and this is discussed in a recent, I think, extraordinarily provocative and interesting paper, which was posted by my colleague Sean Hartnell. And so what he observed, which is closely related to what Andre is, the point Andre is raising, is there are separate issues about whether there is some ultimately coherent behavior of the system and whether there are coherent quasi-particles. One can imagine systems in which the quasi-particles decay very rapidly, but the current, the momentum, say, of the electron fluid only relaxes very slowly, in which case there is a rate-limiting step, which is the relaxation of momentum, which occurs on some very long time scale, which could give you some high conductivity even if you didn't have quasi-particles. So it goes the other way. But the other thing that's associated with these bad metals is that either if you have a peak in the conductivity at low temperature, at low frequency, the width of the peak is of order the temperature. So it's of order the sort of the extrinsic scales. It's not anything to do with a long time scale dumping momentum to the to the lattice. And in fact, in some systems, as a function of temperature, the conductivity goes from being maximum at zero frequency to having a local minimum at zero frequency, which is certainly showing you lack of anything coherent. And one of the astonishing things is that this can happen despite the fact that this behavior is, say, here, and this behavior is, say, here, and the resistivity has shown no change in its T-linear behavior. And that, I've got to say, actually somewhat alarms me, this argument that we made long ago that if there's a crossover, there should be some feature in the T-linear resistivity. I mean, okay, there's something smooth about this. Nonetheless, there is a difference between having a maximum at zero frequency and a minimum at zero frequency, and I don't quite know how the system manages to be T-linear through that. Okay, good.
One quick statement of fact that
heavy fermions tend to be not quite linear, so they'll go precisely as t to the 1.2 or t to the 1.3. And the coup rates are kind of odd, but they seem to go t linear.
But I think those power laws you're talking about are in a different regime of resistivity. Those tend to be much better conductors. The magnitude of the resistivity, I think, is much smaller.
It's changed, but not bad metals.
What?
Well, they're strange metals, but not bad metals.
They're strange, but not bad. Yeah, by bad, I mean in the politically correct sense, resistively challenged. So sorry I went over.